Hello, my name is Ian Larkins of Radius Law, and welcome to our monthly commercial bulletin brought to you in association with LexisNexis. From the 9th of March, court fees increased for money claims exceeding £10,000. The new fee will be 5% of the value of the claim, capped at a maximum fee of £10,000. This change represents a significant uplift in the fees to be charged, ranging from 64% to 481% uplift. In the recent case of Transformers and Rectifiers versus Needs, it was decided that neither party could rely on its standard terms and conditions. Both parties had been trading for 20 years. The claimant had supplied its purchase order with terms and conditions on the reverse, although there was not any reference to the terms on the front page. When ordering by fax or email, it had not included the terms at all. The defendant had argued that its terms and conditions applied, as they were referred to in its acknowledgement of the order. The judge added that a particular problem in this case was that there was not any consistent process for ordering the goods. This case illustrates the point that without a signed contract, there will always be a risk of uncertainty about the contracting terms. In the case of Intercity Telecom and another versus Solanke, it was held that an employee had breached his duties to his employer and in particular his confidentiality obligations. It was found that the employee, who had been in a senior sales position, had downloaded customer information onto memory sticks and then used that information to solicit customers. The court ordered that the defendant to pay his former employer over £290,000 and to deliver up the stolen information. This is a good news story, showing that companies that have strong contractual provisions and processes can take effective action to prevent employees from stealing their confidential information and know-how. A new provision, Section 56 of the Data Protection Act, came into force on the 10th of March. The effect is to make it a criminal offence to require someone to use a subject access request to obtain and produce their criminal record. This is most likely in the context of an employer-employee relationship. It is legitimate for an employer or prospective employer to seek criminal record information, but this should be done through authorised channels, normally the Disclosure Barring Service, but save where exceptions apply, only unspent convictions are notified. The government has announced from the 6th of April it will be easier for the Information Commissioner's Office, the ICO, to issue fines of up to £500,000 against businesses that make nuisance calls or messages. Under existing law, the ICO needs to show that the call, email or text was of a type likely to cause substantial damage or distress. Under the new regime, the ICO will only need to prove that it was serious and either deliberate or that the business knew the breach was likely. The government also has a stated aim of making board-level executives responsible. With this change and the news that just a few days ago the ICO conducted a raid on a company believed to be using automatic dialing technology about debt management without consent, now is clearly a good time to review any cold calling or messaging practices that may be utilised in your business. Is your business screening against the TPS Do Not Call list for consumers? Do you have good internal suppression lists to stop calling consumers that have asked you to stop? You may have handed this over to your marketing agency, but you will still be responsible for their actions, or indeed lack of. We recently tested the systems of a large motor retailer and a hotel chain by asking them to stop marketing to us. Despite these requests, the marketing has continued. Don't forget the guidance produced by Which in conjunction with ICO that we have previously reported on, and you can find the link in the written version of this bulletin. The ASA has ruled that a mail shop from Amazon misled consumers about subscription fees. The mail shop offered a 30-day free trial to its Prime and video service. In the small print, it stated that the subscription starts after the free trial unless cancelled. The ASA held that the information was not sufficiently prominent to make clear the extent of the commitment. This is an interesting case, as in our view, the practices of Amazon are not unusual, and therefore it provides some helpful guidance to other businesses that may be considering similar promotions. The ASA has published the top 10 most complained about ads in 2014. Not all of the complaints were upheld, and it's worth a read as it gives some real insight into the ASA's thinking on where it draws the line. Paddy Power obtained the infamous number one spot for promoting the betting on the outcome of the Oscar Pistorius trial. the 5,525 complaints were upheld in this case. It's not unusual for companies to want to restrict existing generous benefit and particularly defined benefit pension schemes. If your business wishes to cut back on what it offers to staff, it will make sense to first read about the recent IBM case. The judgment on remedies demonstrates the importance of treating members fairly and getting the consultation process right. Otherwise, it's likely that changes will get unravelled. There is too much detail to go into in this bulletin, but briefly, it has been confirmed that firstly, IBM's attempted exclusion notices from the defined benefit scheme are voidable. Secondly, the non-pensionability agreements to prevent future pay increases being pensionable on a defined benefit basis are unenforceable. And thirdly, IBM's breached its duty of trust and confidence to some members who took early retirement options and are likely to face compensation claims. ACAS has changed its guidance on the right to be accompanied at grievance and disciplinary hearings. This followed a 2013 case, Toolen and Orr GB Oils, which suggested that the guidance did not reflect the law. The Employment Rights Act states that workers have a right to be accompanied if they make a reasonable request. The problem, however, is that reasonable request is not defined. The old ACAS guidance had stated it would not normally be reasonable to insist on being accompanied by a colleague who worked in a remote office if there was a suitable and willing colleague who was based more locally. The guidance has now been updated to allow the worker a wider choice of companion. We reported last month on the first case of obesity being classed as a disability. Now an employment tribunal in Northern Ireland has ruled that obese employees may be entitled to disability protection. The landmark case involved a former employee of Randox Laboratories who brought a claim alleging that he had been discriminated against because of his obesity. The claimant said that he had been harassed by fellow employees for over 4 years and that the abuse he was suffering intensified considerably until he eventually went on sick leave due to stress. He left his job in June 2014. Thank you for joining us for this month's Commercial Legal Bulletin. The podcast is available to download on the website together with the written report. We welcome your feedback on the news stories featured today, and please remember to share with your colleagues. We'll be back next month with another update. Until then, thank you and goodbye.